this approach to AI has been used in products in ways that people don't realize.
When you do a Google search, when you want to find a photo on your phone,
we can talk to our cell phones and they will respond to us as though they understood what we actually said.
That's all done by neural networks. In future, much more is going to be done by neural networks.
Those services that you're aware of and the way they operate today wouldn't be the way they are were not for this technology. My dad absolutely never set out to, you know, build a company or build a technology or build something like that. My dad set out to understand how people think and learn. And eventually he figured out that this neural, what we now call neural network approach, was a real superior way to sort of model and then understand and explore human thinking and learning.
I use neural networks because I'm interested in how our minds work. So Dave Rumelhart and I started working together in the late 70s.
In the late 1970s, almost everybody in conventional AI thought that using neural networks was just nonsense. David Rumelhart's major contribution was that he rediscovered and pioneered the use of the backpropagation algorithm, which is a very effective way to learn complicated neural networks, and is actually the way all these current large language models are learned.
A neural network is like a network of people who are all friends sending messages to each other, except they send very simple messages. They either get more excited or calm down a little bit. If there are neurons in your brain that do these jobs, it must be there must be some learning process that tells our neurons how to wire themselves up to build that neural network.
In your brain, you have a lot of neurons. They have connection strengths between them. And when you learn, you change the strengths of those connections. And the backpropagation algorithm is a way of deciding whether, if you increase the strength of a connection, it'll make the neural network work better or worse at the task you just gave it. So let's take an example of you have a neural network and you'd like it to say yes if there's a bird in the image and no if there's no bird in the image. But what you really want to do is show it an image of a bird and then ask the question, how do I change the strengths of the connections so the feature detectors are better at detecting birds? That's what backpropagation does. It sends information backwards through the network to figure out how to change all the connection strengths to make it better at giving the right answer.
Basically, the purpose we had for forming that group was to demonstrate the usefulness of these neural network kinds of models. In the end, it turned out to be a two-volume pair of books called Parallel Distributed Processing. The breakthroughs that we had in the 1980s were very exciting to people for several years. And there was this wave of interest in neural networks that carried into the late 90s. Then it began to fade. The learning algorithm that Dave and Jeff had introduced seemed like it wasn't powerful enough, or it was so slow that it could never solve the problem.
In computer science, people lost interest in neural networks because they discovered other methods that worked about as well on small data sets. And at that point, nobody had any really big data sets.
The thing is that the computers started to get faster.
So work done by my students in 2012 was what really broke the dam. That's when huge numbers of computer scientists suddenly started believing, hey, these neural networks really work. They managed to use NVIDIA GPU boards to recognize 1,000 different kinds of objects using a database developed by Fei-Fei Li that was big enough so that neural networks really worked much better than any other technique.
It produced a very big improvement in one step compared to the state of the art before that. And suddenly it got everybody's attention around these ideas again. My hope and expectation is that we will come to see neural network-based artificial intelligence systems as resources that sort of leverage our own human capabilities.
I absolutely think about my dad when we think about AI today. There's a direct line from the work that he did to some of the most advanced of AI technologies now.
If you look at any of the really big breakthroughs, they come from basic scientific curiosity. But once the basic science had been done, that has clearly led to an industry which now people think of as a trillion-dollar industry. So curiosity is what drives scientists, and they do their best work when they're trying to solve puzzles that they're really curious about. That's the goose that lays the golden eggs.